those are my non-exhaustive checklist, and after that, let us get into one after another. So again, we come back to the interoperability, and at the system integration level, interoperability is the biggest concern. As we have already seen, basically by interoperability, we mainly consider the EHR level interoperability between different systems, but also there is interoperability between the different devices that we are using on the body. But we are mainly concerned, if the things are on the body, then basically it is much simpler, because I am the person in charge of describing that. But when it comes to the system to system level interoperability, then I am not in charge. So that is why essentially we have to look into the interoperability at the system level, because different IT systems and software applications to communicate, exchange data accurately, effectively and consistently, that's what we actually need from our system. And there are different levels of interoperability. So level 0 means no interoperability at all. Level 1 essentially means technical and syntactical interoperability, but no semantic interoperability. So syntactic level is essentially describing the messages, clinical documents and just agreed vocabularies, but not the archetype based kind of model sort of thing to give the entire information. Then comes level 2, where we have two orthogonal levels of partial semantic interoperability. One of them is level 2A, which is unidirectional semantic interoperability, and the other one is bidirectional semantic interoperability of meaningful fragments. Meaningful fragments, okay. And by semantic level, what we say is that it is basically advanced messaging, common information model, the disease model, all of those things there. And then finally, at the level 3 is full semantic interoperability. So there, these are the different levels of interoperability, and when we will develop the system in the integration level, the point is we need to consider which are the probable systems my system is going to be interfaced with. And according to that, I have to have a dialogue with that system to find out which level of interoperability I can introduce in my system, so that they can access me, I can access them, and so on. Now, prerequisites: agreement on a standard reference model, standardized service interface models to provide interoperability between healthcare services and other services, etcetera, which I have already kind of covered within the EHR thing. We have the domain specific concept like archetype, and typically the standardized terminology is associated with controlled vocabularies, and this is actually recommended by European Commission's DG Information Society. So whatever European Commission funded projects we do, we actually have to conform with whatever described over here. And these prerequisites have already given rise to the EHR, open EHR dual model approach, which I have already said that one is the standardized approach, and on top of that you have the archetypes. And basically what happens is that with that, the generalized model, which is kind of fixed model, the reference model, this is a static one, and that is conforming with level 1 interoperability, which is my technical and syntactic interoperability. But when we add the archetypes on top of that, it comes out as somewhere in the level 2. It could be level 2A or could be level 2B, depending on what type of archetypes we are introducing there. Then comes data portability. Now, portability is essentially what it means: to what extent the data in the EHR could be transferred from one system to the other. Partial, whole, what is there? And what should be the format for such a data exchange? And in a service oriented environment, what happens is that you need to have a number of features to ensure that the data is portable. The first one is AAA: authentication, authorization and accounting. So authentication is a framework that kind of covers all the control aspects of the data. How? Authentication is the way to identify the participants. So let's say for my father, I am the authentic person to access the information, right? So when I will have my personal ID, then I can, entering that ID, I can actually see what the status of my dad is, okay? But that does not mean that I have authorization. So I, as the son, is authenticated by the system with some sort of thing to go into the system, but what am I authorized to see is a different thing. Am I authorized to see the raw data, or I am authorized to see only the top level thing, your father is fine. So therefore, that sort of thing needs to be incorporated there. So essentially, authorization is a kind of framework that legitimates the entity, which is I, let us say in this case, in the interaction with the system, receiving permissions from the owner of the information. The owner of the information could be my dad, could be the clinician or whoever, okay? And then finally comes the accounting, and the accounting is the capability associated with the resources that allows tracking the tasks and measures applied. So if I once again go back to my example, so I am authenticated, I am authorized to see something, but am I also accounted for some of the training schedules that were given to my dad? So basically, am I responsible person for that, or can I change the training schedule for my dad with my authentication and authorization? So this is actually different. So all these three things need to be considered when we consider the data portability or accessibility. Then it is the availability of the data. So ability to ensure that the services, channels and resources and the other processes work properly, and the information is accessible in a trustworthy way. That is the availability of the data. So if I try to find out what data is there for blood pressure over the last 7 days, if it comes as that it is just throwing up the data for just one day, it is not going to satisfy my purpose. And that is what is covered in the availability section. It actually stops the so-called denial of service attack. So what happens is that somebody can hack into the system and can start to deny my access into that system, so that a person can meet to the slow death, okay? Because I can't see what's happening there. Obviously, I am not stupid to just stand back, have to do something different there, but anyway, there is actually quite a lot of incidences, there are quite a lot of incidences for denial of service attacks already in the systems, right? And the bad thing is, it is not only denial of service like not giving you the data, but also it is kind of tempering the system. So what happens is just to change some part of the data so that the thing goes completely wrong and nobody notices. Confidentiality ensures that the information cannot be accessed by unauthorized entities, and that means that I need to have very, very strong encryption algorithm there. Integrity, it refers to the protection of information that is exchanged, that is providing assurance that the information has not been tampered with. But how can we know that the information is not tampered with? There needs to be certain kind of measures, and you know, there are lots of research in the software community at this moment going on to ensure how you can embed the checking for integrity, checking for confidentiality and checking for privacy in the data system. This kind of huge area of work at this moment going on. Privacy. As I said, privacy is different from confidentiality or security, because privacy is something like, I just do not want you to know what kind of disease I have. That is my private property, right? So in that case, this is also somehow related to the authentication and authorization as well in that sense. So the data portability, when I am defining the data portability protocol, then I have to consider all of these things, and all of these things will needs to be ironed out before I am able to make my data completely portable. Now, finally, what comes out is the deployment, and the deployment workflow goes with like different steps, and it actually each step of these are iterated along the whole project life cycle using something called 4 unified phases. We will see them a little bit later, and what happens with all these unified phases is that every phase will give rise to something after iteration and finally to the completion, a series of what we call artifacts. And those artifacts then are the ingredients for pulling into the whole system. So, if I just look at that, so these are 4 different unified processes. One is the inception phase, one is the elaboration phase, one is the construction phase, one is the transition phase. Okay? So, let us say that this is defining our deployment cycle. So, just taking an example, bill of material. Right. So, you are just purchasing the material, you have to put the bill and so on. Right at the inception level, what you need to do is that what are the things my system will need, what are the things I need to purchase. Right. So, that is what is the basic inventory, I look for the bill for material. Okay. Then we come to the elaboration phase, when we start to really think of theoretical design. So, elaboration phase and the inception phase, you can see I can draw a parallel example from yesterday's lab. So, inception phase is I want to develop an LDA classifier in hardware, that is my inception. And on elaboration is what I was drawing on the board as a kind of black box, that this will be input, this will be output and so on, so on, and what should be the different components, kind of rough sketch there, right. And when we do that thing, then we actually start to look into the component that we actually need. So, basically we go through a draft phase, right. And along with the draft phase, right at elaboration phase, I have to think about the deployment plan. It has to go in parallel, it is not that it can wait for the later thing. Then comes the construction, where we start to write down the code, right. And that is where we are getting more information about the structured inventory, because this was the draft at this moment. Now, we know that okay, initially I thought that that is needed, but that is not needed, something like that is needed. But now, you see over the cycles, it is becoming more and more concise, precise and rock solid, right. And then from there, we do from the draft deployment plan based on the material now we have. Essentially, what happens is that I know the behavior of the material that I am using. So, I have a clear idea of what type of deployment plan I have to do. So, for example, if I say that at this stage, I understand that I need to use a magnetometer. And once I find out that I do not need an accelerometer, but a magnetometer, then in my deployment plan, I am going to put in there should be no ferromagnetic substance nearby. You see, this is kind of simple example. And then finally, once we do that construction, then it goes to the transition, which is the final thing, and obviously a finally refined deployment plan. So, not only delivery of software or hardware components, but also provision of proper training materials, activities, assistance coverage, and define the timing through the process cycle. That is what is needed. Now, if we just consider the main diagram. So, that is the planned deployment, right. Now, we have here the support material and the acceptance test. These are the two things we need to do. So, let us just look at the support material. At the inception phase, there is not that much, to be honest, for the support material, because until I reach to the point where I know I am going to use a magnetometer, I do not know what type of support material I will need to provide to the patient, right. So, at the inception phase, support material is not that important, but it will start to get into a draft phase right here in the elaboration phase. When I know that right, I need to monitor the movement of this person, when I got that point, then I immediately start to get some draft things that okay, that person should be following A, B, C, D, something like that, not more than that. That is why it is still at the draft phase. And obviously, if the person needs to do A, B, C, D, then what are the support thing, assistance service I will need for that person. So that will start in the elaboration phase. And then we move to the construction phase, where we are starting with the training material, we are starting to really kind of prototype building there. Obviously, this end user support material, it will start to develop now, and also the assistance service will start to be refined according to the more kind of precise definition of each of the components. And finally, we reach to the transition set, where again we refine the training material that you need to do this thing. For example, the training material for the stroke back project was the patient need to sit in front of the patient workstation to do this ABCD exercises, and that data will be going into the system to retrain the band network. So that is the refined training material and how to use those, how to wear those sensors on the body, because I do not know whether you have used this portable blood pressure measurement systems yet. So if you have used that, probably you have seen that if you keep your hand like this, the reading is different to if you put it like that, right? So which one shall I trust? A patient will not understand that, right? So in this case, the doctor has to, or we have to provide a material which will clearly say that no, you need to keep your hand like this, you need to be in that position for 2 minutes or 3 minutes still, and after that whatever reading comes, you read it. Otherwise, whatever the patient will read is a completely wrong data, and if I try to trust that wrong data, the patient is in danger. So over the time, it is refined, the training material is refined, end user support material is also refined, and finally, the assistance service is in the build up phase. So this actually covers the deployment of the full range of information required by the end users using this support material that we need. So in this case, we need, for example, although I gave you a completely kind of naive example, but it needs software specification, some use case, navigation map, graphical interface, training material, support material, whatever you can think of there for supporting the person. Then comes the acceptance test in our cycle. So if we go back to the cycle, acceptance test. Now the acceptance test is something that needs to be starting right at the inception phase. So when you are thinking of developing a product, you right there start to think about acceptance plan, that I am building this product for these people. How will the people accept it, and how am I going to test it? And again, through different phases of elaboration, construction, transition, this thing starts to evolve. So acceptance test, here it is refined acceptance plan, which will result into acceptance test. Plan is essentially different, because I want to see how the person behaves in a room. That is my plan. But for doing that, what type of tests I need to do, that is a different issue. You see? So essentially in the construction phase, they got completely refined one after another, do some kind of test result, and if they are accepted, that is fine. If no, then just go back, refine the acceptance test, and so on. So ensure the product is acceptable to the customer prior to its release. Formal testing supervised by the customer performed at the developmental site, using target environment, kind of simulated sort of thing, and conducted to determine whether the system satisfies the acceptance criteria. So basically, you need to define the acceptance criteria, and you need to talk to the people for who you are developing this to get the acceptance criteria. So those are kind of developing in these phases. And then we come to the delivery unit and the beta test. So this is kind of the prototype unit, but this prototype is more or less a finished one, okay? So this is the deployment unit, we call it typically deployment unit. It is ready to be effectively installed and used. It can consist of software, it can consist of other system components like hardware and etcetera, does not matter. But this has to go through something called beta test. What happens there is a subset of user can use this unit to install the software, can configure the devices, connect to networks, and so on, all sorts of these things. And finally, obviously, it starts at the elaboration phase. Before that, it is difficult to conceive. And in the beta test, what will happen is that it will show the application's usability and stability. for the target population. That will certainly give a feedback for the subset of from the subset of intended users to refinement of the things, and also during the construction phase, deployment manager should be defining some measurement parameters for validating and monitoring the tests. And then we come to the product delivery. Obviously, the delivery is not at the inception phase, but the delivery procedure should start right at the elaboration phase, where we start with the package, how it will look like, and then in the construction phase, it is this package product is enriched and also defining what type of servers, what type of softwares, etcetera, etcetera, we need to be deploying there. And finally, at the transition phase, we will just go through all the tests and so on. So, take the deployment unit with all its artifacts and packages, package them for production, and should consider all units of product artworks, manufacturing difficulties, constraints, etcetera, etcetera, right through this product delivery cycles. And so, that is more or less the system integration issues that we need to think of. But remember, the main point is that even if you are not thinking of deployment of something, and if you are not going through the product development cycle right at this moment, you need to be very much careful about those issues around privacy, security, and data interoperability. If these three things are not working, then your system is just a local system, it is not a remote healthcare system. Okay? So, I will just move to the next one, and this is going to be our last one, and I do not intend to keep you here for too long. So, where is it? So, technical things all are gone, now it is hardcore business issue. So, how are we doing? So, let us just try to see the business perspective of this thing, assuming that we are satisfying all of those requirements like interoperability, etcetera, etcetera, and we developed a cycle, the product delivery cycle, developed the product, went through all sorts of tests, and we come to the deployment stage. Obviously, the trouble is we cannot think about the business plan right at that point, because I have already invested lots of resources there and I do not have a business plan, and now what happens if the business falters, right? So, I have to think from the right at the beginning the business perspective. So, for the business thing, what we need to understand is the trends of the healthcare. So, here I go back to the very first lecture that I gave, but it was kind of very short in terms of hard numbers at that point. That is what we want, the trend of healthcare is to give access of healthcare to large number of people, and it is not only access, but quality, better quality of care. And for better quality of care, not only it says that I am getting my medicine at the right point of time, or I am getting somebody coming knocking at my door and saying that, okay, I am here to do you the physiotherapy or something like that. That is not the thing. That when we say quality, it has to be overall thing, like prediction for stopping an event to occur, because that is where we can save money, right? So, all sorts of those quality is embedded in the quality and shift of the economic power towards consumers. So, basically I am in charge of my health, I will probably there is a system which is monitoring me, which will be contacting to the doctors, right, but it is kind of empowers me to take care of myself. So, I go to Tikka, you have seen Tikka, okay, and I just look at that and found out some nice puris there, and I was very greedy to eat puri, and then suddenly my system says, do you remember yesterday how much your cholesterol reading was, and do you know how much is there in that puri? I am pushed back, okay, but that actually empowers me to take my own decision, right. So, that is what is needed. So, that is the shift is happening, that not the doctors all the time telling me that you should be doing that, you should be doing that, because let's face it, most of the things doctors say, we just don't care, right? So anyway, so it kind of giving me some sort of power to control myself and to maintain my own daily life. And also the trouble is there is a dramatic change in demographics and a large number of patients with age-specific chronic degenerative things. Right now the data is saying that about 25% to 60% of the older people suffer from chronic diseases in Europe. And the Europe is kind of top heavy. Top heavy means there are more aged people at this moment than the people who can pay taxes. And so over the period from 2011 to 2030, it's kind of 2030 is predicted, but the data I think is actually valid until 2015 or something like that. If you look at that in the world, United States is spending 5% of its whole GDP. It's at the top. And then comes this group like Greece, Iceland, Austria, Korea, United Kingdom, Portugal, Switzerland, Luxembourg, these people. Then in the next batch comes Australia, Finland, Netherlands, New Zealand, quite high GDP with respect to their national GDP here. Okay? And below that is France, Spain, Norway, etc. And you see, finally, here comes Sweden, Czech Republic, Italy, Ireland, Slovenia, Denmark, Japan. Unfortunately, India doesn't appear in this chart because I don't think there is any sort of structured data for spending how much healthcare cost is going into the public in India. That's an unfortunate thing, but this is the situation now, and that is going to keep on rising this level. So obviously, there is a trend that healthcare cost is rising, and therefore our concept is to go for ICT based hospital. What it can do? It can contain the healthcare delivery cost, it can maintain expected level of quality of care and safety, it can reshape the healthcare beyond the hospital environment and makes its home care or the personal healthcare thing. Because when I am empowered to take care of my own health, I am less prone to make mistakes that will lead me to somewhat dangerous situation, and in that case I don't need to see the doctor. I think that is one reason why some of the doctors are very much nervous that they may be losing their jobs, and that's why they are kind of not believing all these systems, but that's a secondary issue. I'm just joking. And also the thing is that medical app in smartphones. So essentially, the guy who actually introduced this term, he was from Philips Femi, which was looking at the kind of image, medical image scenarios. And then they were part of Barco. Have you heard the name of Barco? Probably you have not. You have heard the name of Sony, right? Sony is number one revenue generator in display technology. Barco is the second largest revenue generator in display technology. But you have not heard the name of Barco, neither was I. Whatever big advertisement in the World Cup football and etc. you see, all are from Barco. All the hospital imaging equipments, they are from Barco. All the things inside those packaged thing is from Barco. So, you know, and this guy actually, he was very much enthusiastic about all these things. His name was Silvio Bonfiglio. And he actually introduced this term, the doctor in your pocket. And I said, Silvio, that's a dangerous term. That's a dangerous term for the doctors. Anyway, he just kept on using it. So I am also using it. There is no doctor here. So I am not in mortal danger anyway. So now, at this moment, about let's say 40,000 of medical applications are available already for your smartphone. And those things, quite surprisingly, they were introduced by SMEs or startup companies, not the big companies. The big companies look for big things, and the small companies, because they can actually develop those small smartphone applications. Even I can do it, you can do it, everybody can do it, right? If we have a little bit of kind of cleverness, we can do it. But then what happens? So these SMEs, I have actually met some of those during our projects. They were over enthusiastic about their applications. They actually got prizes in different competitions, but then there was no selling of product. Why is that? Because whatever they have come up with, that needs certification. And the certification means you need to go through a lengthy process and you need to apply it in real life scenario to clearly show that it is indeed not creating any danger to the patient. Because it is not like any sort of chip design or any sort of communication or kind of telephony sort of thing where you can actually sacrifice some of the quality. And okay, in chip design, what happens if there is a fault in chip design? Some chip will die, money is lost, you will lose your job, but nobody else has died, right? But in this case, people can die, and that is why the certification process is extremely, extremely rigorous. And for the SMEs who are very much over enthusiastic about their apps, they just do not have the resources to do that. Because they have to contact the large hospitals, hospitals have to agree to them to use their apps for monitoring the patients longitudinally for about 1 or 2 years, and then they have to submit that data for the certification process, and then the certification itself will take long time and so on, and that is why most of the SMEs at that point say, I am done. Okay. And also patient population self-monitoring could be one of the most important emerging categories. At that particular phase, what you can see is that there are some companies which actually went for this thing directly. What they said is that what I am giving you is a kind of a fancy sort of stuff, like Fitbits. You put it over here, you look great, pretty much stylish like Salman Khan possibly, but it also captures some of the data. What it does not tell you is that, well, it also all gives the advertisement like you can get to your blood pressure, you can get this, you can get that, etcetera, etcetera, but you will not find anywhere it is saying that this is medically validated or use it for diagnosis. So what happened is that they invested money for that purpose, but then they said that I can't go through this whole process. So, I am making it as a kind of available tool. If you want, you use it. If you die, it is your responsibility. I do not care. I did not tell you to use it for medical purpose, right? But most of us got that kind of idea that, okay, whatever reading it is giving, it is great. It is actually correct. Well, no. And obviously, there are medical imaging. Now, medical imaging is moving into some other direction now, because what happens is that all the time we were talking about this big in-hospital imaging systems and so on and so on, but now people are saying that, okay, why can't I just view my image, I can take my smartphone and take or iPad or whatever, I just take an image. So, I have an abscess or something like that, I can take an image and can upload it to the cloud to go to the doctor, and the doctor can say that, okay, take this medicine, take that medicine, etcetera. But to be honest, that is pretty much in the restricted sense. You can't apply it for all of those things. But now, I think there are new things coming up where there are some smartphone apps and also some kind of wearable sensor array. I was just looking at it some other day, not clear exactly how it works. It is kind of doing some ultrasound for the internal organs. And this ultrasound image was coming into your smartphone, and then you can actually transmit that thing out. But again, the trouble is all these things are fancy things. When the life and death depends on the data, I do not think anybody would like to use this right at this moment until it is proven beyond doubt. Because you know that the resolution of the camera, obviously it is increasing, and obviously it will increase to great extent in the future. But still, how much it is capturing as a kind of ultrasound for the internal organ, I am not entirely sure at this moment. But having said that, there is a trend in that direction. Also then what happens is that that image could be consulted with the doctors, and doctors can say whether the patient is at risk or not if we are able to reach to that point where we can reliably take an image of our internal organ using smartphone or something wearable. Okay. Cloud computing, this part is already making lots of noise in the computing industry, but cloud computing is slowly getting into the healthcare market as well, because cloud is providing you the enormous ability for data storage and data kind of management and so on and so on. So, for example, when I am just uploading the data in the cloud, if there is some kind of cloud EHR sort of system, then I just don't need to care about how to manage the data. I just simply from my computer upload the data and it's done, like a Dropbox or something like that. And obviously, it allows the providers and healthcare delivery organization to focus less on the IT management issues, because they can just see the things and they can immediately start to deliver the stuff. And then people started to talk about the social networks in healthcare. So, how to use the social network in healthcare? I am not a very much fond of social network guys, and in fact, my friends always complain why I am not in Facebook. But I have seen some attempts where Facebook or these type of social networks were kind of tried to be used for gathering healthcare data. So, for example, on the other day you were asking me where you get the data from, right? It is very difficult to get the data from the doctors. What you can do is that you can actually write down in the social network that I am trying to gather the data from different people on the ECG, on the accelerometer, etcetera, etcetera, because I am developing something. Then you will see lots of people already are interested to share their own data. And actually, one of our colleagues tried to go into that route and he really got mountain of data, but then the other problem was that when the people were sending the data, it was not clear what type of conditions they were suffering for. So, my colleague was trying to build up a classifier for something exotic, but then he just did not have the label data. He had data, but no data is labeled clearly. What can you do with that? So, that means that if you want to use the social network, you actually need to create some sort of directives or template or something like that, so that people can adhere to that. And then when you do that, then you will find that the people will be saying, oh, I do not know about those 4 or 5 terms, who cares? But some people may respond. But so there is a, what I am trying to say is that these things are not there already, but there is a trend to go in that direction. And to be honest, I believe firmly that in future those things will come into the picture as kind of different business components. So essentially what we are doing at this moment is that we had the medical initially we had the medical professionals in the hospitals and a diagnosis treatment episodic patients. So basically our healthcare domain was just like that. But now what is happening is that with the IT system development and the digital stuffs, essentially this horizon is getting broadened. Our caregivers, other caregivers are now included, nursing facility is also included online, patients with chronic diseases, management process for those, or the monitoring for early detection, it is coming as the next stage. Then goes the whole entire core of this thing will move into patient's home. And then finally, the patient himself or everywhere else. So, basically the horizon is completely expanding at this moment, from starting from this small core of hospitals. So, ultimately one day may arise that when the hospitals as such will be only existing to do some sort of surgical stuffs. Otherwise, the whole medicine stuffs could be actually done with some kind of distributed virtual hospitals. And the whole process of payment or involvement of the doctors will start to change. Instead of looking at the patients directly, what may happen is that they will be probably charging on the basis of their presence in online hours and something like that. It might come at some point. Right. So, if I just look at the existing e-health market segments at this moment, then according to the European Commission, e-health is the lead market, and the lead market means a market for innovative products and services and technological solutions with high growth potential. So, although you can see lots of stuffs about e-health, the point is the market is still not there. Trend is there, requirement is there, some equipments are there, but the market as a whole, what we call as a kind of business concept, is not there, but it has a tremendous growth potential. So, lots of things can be done. And looking at the different parts of that e-health market, there are basically four segments. One segment is the clinical information system, or CIS. What it does is that it gives a specialized solution for health professionals within the healthcare institutions. So this is the tools for primary care and or outside care institutions like GP surgery or pharmacy. If you go to the NHS system of UK, then what you will see is that the GPs are able to access some part of the NHS system which are providing guidance for the GPs. And the way they work is that before prescribing any sort of medicine to you, they will actually consult there what are the side effects of that medicine, whether you accept, you are accepting that side effect or not, and so on and so on. So basically that is one part of the system, clinical information system, that is in use but in isolated pockets. Okay. The second one is the secondary usage non-clinical system, or SUNCS. What it does is that there, this is kind of, let us say, software services that gives health education or promotion. It is a specialized systems mainly for the researchers and public data collection and analysis. So, for example, PhysioNet database. It is a repository for lots of ECGs and EEGs and etcetera, etcetera. This is falling under that category. So, you have lots of those type of things there. Third thing is the telemedicine, which we more or less know. It is a kind of personalized disease management, remote monitoring, teleconsultation, telecare, teleradiology. The way it works is basically the nurse is picking up the phone and calling you, how are you, what is your temperature, and so on, take the all the data, thank you very much, have a nice day, right? That is the end of that. And the teleradiology, obviously the PACS solution and so on, you can just upload those radiological images. And the final one is the integrated health clinical information network, which has the distributed EHR and associated services such as e-prescription, e-referrals and so on. So in NHS there is one thing, so for example, when my wife went to some sort of stomach problem, the gastroenterologist did not find anything, but the gastroenterologist said that I think you have got some problem with somewhere else. And then he could use that system just by writing a prescription and referral, which will automatically be forwarded to the relevant department, and the relevant department will be responding to me on the within the next, let us say, 1 week or something like that. Okay. So these are different fragments of the entire system that we are talking about. And if I just look at this, the biggest use of this system is that guy. Secondary usage non-clinical system, that means health education or promotion, and specialized system for researchers and public health data collection and analysis. That actually covers 71.6% of the market, which is basically background tool to understand the thing. But in terms of real application, so for example, clinical information system, or CIS, if you look at that, that part is only 13.5% of the whole market at this moment. And that is because the GPs are using this, or the GPs are forced to use this system. Telemedicine, something we always kind of fancied about, it is only 0.9% share of the e-health market. Now, this is the reality. Whatever big talks we keep on talking about, this is the reality. The market, you can see the real component of the market, real usable components are only these three, while this is actually the background research one. So you can see that with the trend that we are seeing nowadays, how much you can gain in this market if you really try to expand this one, that one, or that one. And now if I just look at the availability of healthcare products, fully mainstream products, there is none in the whole world. Partially mainstream products, like kind of combination of all these fours, it is in US. Not very efficient, but theoretically I can say that yes, there is something there. Localized instances, okay, for all those partial products, if I just think about that, in localized instances, is in Denmark, Spain, Finland, United Kingdom, Germany and Sweden. Nowhere else. Only pilot and trial activities for these type of systems in Italy, France, Hungary, the Netherlands, Poland and Japan. Little or no activities all the other countries. So, you see how many countries are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Only 13 countries, even then they are not fully, but I am kind of forcefully putting this thing into this only the pilot activity as also something available. Only 13 countries are using any sort of e-health product. For the rest of the countries, there is absolutely nothing. So, you see if you can develop something like that, what you can change in Africa or even right here. And when I was discussing to do that thing with the people here, everybody was saying that it is not possible to do it here because of this thing, because of that thing, and obviously the most obvious thing is the political thing rather than any sort of technical thing. It is not the technical inability, it is basically the political thing. And what it says that the estimated time to mainstream adoption of healthcare product is still a long way and it is about 10 to 15 years. But believe me, I think this 10 to 15 years is only for this section of these three batches of the countries. I do not know how long it will take to spread it out to those countries. So, what are the factors actually impacting the uptake? Number one is lack of coordinated policies. Different countries have their own financial approaches. So, typically countries work with different sorts of revenue structures. So, some of the countries work with a system that is centered around public taxation. Some of them has compulsory social insurance like UK, we have to pay compulsory amount of money as a national insurance and the healthcare comes as part of that. Then model based on private finances through voluntary insurances, private insurance, that is a pretty much the system in US and some of the other countries. This one, a kind of combination of these is existing in the Scandinavian countries and they have very good healthcare system. And the other cost sharing mechanisms through which patient contribute to the healthcare financing, just like here. We go to the doctors, we pay the fees, then we go to the medicine shop, we buy the medicine, it is all on us, right? Nothing comes out from whatever we have paid as a tax to the government. Anyway, so these are the different systems. So, how can you actually build a system that is kind of spreading from UK to India to Africa or US? Because the taxation system is completely different. If I come to India and if I want to see a doctor, then I have to pay it from my pocket. Then there has to be a coordinating model that my national insurance I paid in UK has to be transferred to India to pay the doctor and something like that. So, you see that these are kind of real problems there. And then there are market barriers and drivers, because market is absolutely fragmented. Some people just develop some sensors, some people develop some softwares without caring about how to interface them. There is absolutely no coordinated activity. And believe me, I have seen it firsthand with our Chiron project, where there were 28 partners from 18 countries. And you could see the cultural difference, the way they approach to the problem, the way they just do not care about what other people were doing. And finally, as I said, we were ending up working up to 1 o'clock in the night in Barcelona and just trying to sort out the interface problem rather than testing the whole system. Okay. And then high initial cost. As I said, that all the apps are available, but then the trouble is certification. That goes back to the patient trial. For that, you need to have money. If you do not have huge amount of money behind you, you are not going to be able to overcome that barrier. And the big drivers, but the thing is that these are market fragmented, high initial cost. Despite all these things, what is happening is the drivers, what is the big drivers of the market? It is basically the growth of aging population and prevalence of chronic diseases. That is where the business potential actually lies. Then there is something like political, because different countries have their legal structures, different legal structures. European countries are under European law, European Court of Justice, And now after Brexit, I don't know what will happen to UK. Probably they will revert back to Crown Court or whatever. And then India has something else, America has something else. So again, the thing is, I'm just giving you a small example. Then you can see the problem of legality there. Vijay Mallya, okay? Extraditing case running in UK. Will India get him? Possibly not. Just like Sanjeev Chawla, he was not extradited. Why? Because the condition of the jail is not right according to the European law. Okay? Here, if we are, we just see that, why, the jail is absolutely fine, it is absolutely legal to us, but to them, the condition you are going to subject Vijay Mallya in is inhuman. So it's the interpretation of the legality at two different points. And this is a pretty much a naive example. Now you can see, when you are dealing with the market as sensitive as healthcare, what kind of legal implications can come because of the different interpretation and different types of laws. Okay? So that is a big political issue that somebody needs to solve. Then facilitating the market deployment for fostering, this is another one. Fostering interoperability and common medical technologies and technical standards, this is another big problem, because none of the countries are coming together to make something completely interoperable. In Europe, it is happening to some extent, because they are kind of European countries are under European Union, they visualize themselves like kind of, okay, we are kind of one big chunk like that, but then they have their own problems. So launching pilot actions for testing different business models, because you just don't know which type of business model will work, and then you have to actually check for different types of parallel business models and try to see what happens at the end. And supporting the development of best practices and fostering their sharing across geographical boundaries for design of sustainable and value creating business model. That's something needed. So what we need is a new approach. It's a kind of synergic effort that is needed. So we need effort from all the stakeholders towards a common objective, that we want to make life of the people better. Okay? Back in your mind, you are thinking about generating revenue, that's fine, but put some effort in doing that. That is the main thing. So unless that is done, there is no way we can come down to kind of synergic effort. Community supported service. Now in the UK, or let's say Sweden, Germany, there are kind of structure like community support. So what does that mean is that, for example, there is a person who is ill and an aged person. That person's responsibility is taken by the community. So there are community people, so appointed by the governments with the different community organizations, they actually support those people. So even a lady, an aged lady who is unable to move, the marketing, food preparation and the other things will be done by somebody else from that community organization, and they will be coming to the doorstep to deliver all these things, right? And this is the way they now perceive how the healthcare should also be going for the elderly people. And what happens there is that those community organizations, they need to be empowered with those clinical tools and so on, so that they can take the care down to the elderly people or the others, or the vulnerable people, let's say. It is not the clinician that needs to always intervene. It's not the nurse who always need to intervene. It's the community, it's the care of the community. So empower the community to make the community better. What it means is that we will need a big cultural change, because that means that we need to accept the new solutions by the relevant community. I have an interesting experience when I was dealing in the Michelangelo project, and the psychologists were saying that at one point we had some kind of discussion, technical thing against the psychological things, etc. Obviously, we were kind of over a few glasses of red wine and whiskies and so on. So there was a kind of really heated discussion. And then suddenly one of the psychologists or psychiatrists actually blurted out, saying that we don't need technology. So what? And then I was kind of just looking at him and said that, Right. You said that you are using MRI, right? He said, yes. I said, what is that? Is it a psychiatric device or what? Who made that? And then he stopped. But what it tells you is that this guy, because we were talking about developing a new sort of modality for monitoring. But the point is, those guys were using MRI machine and they just feel it is there, right? When you are coming with a new solution for a new device, they are reluctant to accept it at the very beginning. And it happened with all those things. But you know, you need to start pushing at some point, otherwise you will never be able to overcome that thing. And interoperability is obviously coming up over and over and over. And finally, what we need to do is to go for user-centered design, as I probably have been able to show you how much important is person-centric design is, because it can just go completely wrong in a generic sense. So these are different components people are talking about for the business model. To be honest, I don't understand that very much, but they always show this type of figure. And so essentially there is a process of process and organization, which is mainly controlling the networks of patents, activities and resources, and then go with the value proposition, so offered practices, offered products, services and so on. Marketing is marketing, we know what marketing is, and at the very bottom, covering all this aspect is my revenue model. That is the sustainability of economy, so we have to go through that. So now it seems that at least in Europe, people have came to a point where they realized that they need what we call a collaborative business model, where all the different fragments need to be brought in with one common goal of collaboration. And that is where people need to sacrifice their own things as well. I can't be selfish completely. If I really want to generate revenue, I have to accept that I have to sacrifice something. Only then I can get in. Otherwise, the whole solution is not going to work at all, as we have seen over the years. Because big companies like Philips and then let's say GE or the others, they were only concerned about their own products, own selling and so on. So they were getting revenue from there. But their effort is not changing the society. And actually what we are seeing nowadays is a kind of result of the business model those companies have followed until now. They were selling it to the hospitals, but then hospital cost rises, common people suffers, we pay taxes. Why are you building those machines? Why are you generating these revenues? Only for your own family or for the society? And that's what we need to do now. We need to decide on which way we want to go. And I mean, you guys are pretty much eager in coming into this course. I don't know how much I was able to fulfill your expectation, but I think one message I just want to give you is that unless you guys are starting to think about in terms of society, I don't think our country will rise, whatever digital thing Modi keeps on giving. And therefore, it needs a real thought of what is needed in our country. So for example, I'm telling you, right at this moment, the UK government is spending something like 4.6 billion or something like that pound only to develop socially impactful research in the third world countries. And it's a huge chance for India to get into that scheme, because the money comes from the UK government. And so lots of Indian institutes, they can come over and they can actually try to develop the whole system, just a demonstration system for 4 hospitals or 5 hospitals. Saying is very simple, but if you try to analyze the things in our country's scenario, it is nearly impossible. But why is it impossible? That is the thing for you guys to think. So in the end, the remote healthcare market is in nascent phase. It's pretty much fragmented. It has tremendous potential of growth. Demands are growing, but several roadblocks still need to overcome. This often too much technology focused approach failed this particular area. This is something that happens with all the big companies. They are, and also the engineers. We are so excited when we develop a new algorithm or a new sensing device. We want to show the capability of that thing. rather than thinking in terms of the person's need. Therefore, what happens? It becomes so overcomplicated for that person that he or she says, leave it, I will go to the doctor. Okay? And that is what is a serious problem all over the world. And then, so combining all of those things, sometimes people can claim that e-health system and its underlying business models are creating values, but there is no clear proof of that. Because the market is so much fragmented and the real product is used by so little people. You see that the research thing is about 71%, right? The rest of the thing is product. With that sort of small thing, how can you expect to get a clear idea of how much impact it will give on the market? We can theoretically think of, okay, this can be done, this can be done, that can be done, but there could be some hidden things in there. Unless we get in there, we can't find it out. And obviously, this is a complex process due to the fact that available literature provides unclear guidance in actually quantifying or qualifying the benefits achieved with the introduction of such an e-health system. There is no clear guidance on quantifying or qualifying things, qualitative things, because we haven't been there. It is there in the future. Whether we can go there or not, it's an issue, but right now we cannot claim that we can solve all the problems with this, because we haven't seen the whole world yet. And that is all from me in terms of lecturing. Thank you very much for kind of tolerating me for so long time.